Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions, and the first portfolio is Rural Affairs, Land Reform and Islands. I would remind members that questions 4 and 8 are grouped together, and therefore I will take any supplementaries on these questions after both have been answered. And at question number 1, I call Jamie Halkrell-Johnson. Who is joining us?
To ask the Scottish Government how it ensures that the most accurate and up-to-date science and data is used when making decisions that impact Scotland's fishing sector.
Cabinet Secretary Mary Gujol.
It is critical that the best available science is used for management of Scotland's fisheries. The Marine Directorate makes a significant investment of £9 million in an annual programme of data collection, dedicated fisheries surveys, stock assessments and scientific advice. And much of this is delivered in partnership with the industry and academia and through international collaboration under the auspices of ICES, the International Council for the Exploration of the Seas. And it follows standardised, transparent and quality assured procedures. Fisheries managers also draw on socio-economic evidence such as that published in the annual Sea Fisheries Statistics Report.
Jamie Halkrell-Johnson.
After I repeatedly raised the issue of a derogation for catching squid with the government, the Cabinet Secretary finally wrote to me in May admitting, and I quote, "We have concluded that there is not sufficient evidence to support the immediate introduction of a derogation, but there is also not sufficient evidence to refuse it, so no derogation was granted." And I recently met with the industry over other restrictions announced in May, which used data collected between 2016 and 2019 to restrict some larger shellfish vessels from their traditional grounds. Both of these decisions, which impact on fishermen's livelihoods, have been made using old or insufficient data, data which fishermen do not believe reflect what they're seeing on the grounds. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, does she have confidence in the data being used to make these decisions? And relating to the crab and lobster restriction from the 12th of May, can the Cabinet Secretary tell me when the assessment of these restrictions, which was meant to be concluded later this year but has been pushed to next year, will finally be published?
Cabinet Secretary.
The member raises a few different points in there, so I will try and address those as best I can. I think on the last point about the crab and lobster, now, obviously, and we'd said at the time that these are interim measures, which we are going to keep under review while we look at measures more widely. And, of course, if there are any changes there, as we develop those discussions, we will do that with our stakeholders and with the industry as well. But I think just to come back to, I think, the initial point of his question, which was about the squid fish. I do think it's really important to note that there was a limited trial that was granted by Scottish ministers to undertake a pilot project there, and that was with a limited number of inshore vessels to really help try and gather more information to support a longer-term policy decision on fishing for squid. So I do think that that is a really positive step forward, and I think that I believe that the first stakeholder co-management group actually took place earlier, just towards the end of last week on the 1st of November, and that included representatives from industry as well as from ENGOs too. And I believe that that first meeting was thought to be very productive. And of course, there was a lot of enthusiasm there from industry to establish the project ahead of the next fishing season. So I do think that we are moving in the right direction when it comes to that fishery.
Supplementary, Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Regarding data, and according to the available data, can the Cabinet Secretary outline what the economic impact of Brexit has been on Scotland's fishing sector according to this data?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think one thing we can say for sure is that all the promises that were made for Brexit, and particularly in relation to our fisheries, just simply did not materialise. We didn't see the sea of opportunity come to fruition as we had been promised at that time. And I think we also see an impact when you look at our seafood industry, when you look at the impact on exports, the added costs and the bureaucracy that have been added to our businesses here. So when it comes to Brexit and the wider impact, we know that it has had a devastating impact for businesses, but we'll always continue to do what we do for our industry in Scotland, and that's why our negotiators are working really hard at the moment to secure the best opportunities for our fishing industry.
Supplementary, Liam MacArthur.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary will know from our earlier correspondence and discussions about the concerns over the failures to designate Scapa Flow in Orkney as a designated mud area to risk completely undermining the important prawn fishery. The seabed of Scapa Flow is similar to that of Burgh Head, which has been designated. All the data to support the case for designating Scapa Flow has now been provided to the Scottish Government. So will the Cabinet Secretary take the steps necessary to ensure Scapa Flow is designated as soon as possible so this valuable and sustainable local fishery in Orkney can continue?
Cabinet Secretary.
I appreciate that Liam MacArthur has raised this point with me previously and has really been driving this issue forward in Parliament. And I understand that officials had recently met with Liam MacArthur, as well as the Orkney Fisheries Association, local fishers, just a couple of weeks ago to discuss that request. I think what I can commit to today is that we will continue to have those discussions with you. I appreciate that this is something that we need to see movement and to see that develop. So I'm more than happy to keep the member up to date as that progresses, and of course treat it with the seriousness that it deserves.
Supplementary, Colin Smith.
Presiding Officer, the Cabinet Secretary will be aware of the request to undertake a trial reopening of the Solway Cockle fishery. In the absence of regular monitoring of stock levels by Marine Scotland, the sector has carried out that work and provided the data to Marine Scotland, but it sat with them for months. When will we hear the Government's response to the request? And given the delays, does the Cabinet Secretary think the Government are really meeting its obligations under the Fisheries Act when it comes to using the best available scientific advice and data in its decisions?
Cabinet Secretary.
I mean, as I hope you can appreciate, even from just the round of questions that we've had so far this afternoon, obviously there is a lot happening in our marine space at the moment and a lot of work going on across a number of different fisheries in a number of different areas. Now, I know that the work has been done there. Of course, I need to wait until I haven't seen a copy of that report yet, but to get advice on that before we then determine next steps. And of course, as soon as that information becomes available, I'd be happy to discuss that with the member and set out what the next programme of work will look like.
A supplementary, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Protected areas such as Lamlash Bay and Otake Zone are vital in allowing Scotland's marine life and stocks of commercially important species to recover from overfishing. A skipper recently found guilty of scallop fishing in the zone was fined £4,175 at Kilmarnock Sheriff Court. The Community of Arran Seabed Trust Coast believe the incident and outcome raise issues around the challenges for fisheries management, monitoring and enforcement. Can the Cabinet Secretary advise whether our officials will discuss this incident with Coast and say what lessons can be learned to prevent this from happening again?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think one thing I would want to state right from the outset is that, of course, the Marine Directorate takes incursions into any protected area of our seas seriously and will continue to promote and prevent non-compliance and respond where non-compliance has been detected. And I understand that Marine Directorate officials have met with Coast members to discuss this case. Now, I know that Kenneth Gibson also raises important points about our overall enforcement. I mean, we spend around £23 million a year on our compliance. We have a number of vessels, aircraft, and that is, and we look at all this on a risk-based assessment. But again, we do take any reports very seriously, and I would encourage members of the public to continue to report cases where they think there may have been incursions.
Question number two, Sue Webber.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the potential impact of the UK Government's decision to reform agricultural property relief on the future of family farms in Scotland.
Minister Jim Fairley.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. To say that I'm disappointed that the Chancellor did not listen to the comments from NFUS and Scottish Land and Estates and chose not to work with the Scottish Government to consider the impact of these changes would be an understatement in the extreme. Government, farmers and rural communities now need to come together to think through how the impacts of the UK Government's decision will impact on family farms. In the meantime, I would urge the UK Government to engage in immediate dialogue to ensure any tax changes take account of Scotland and its distinct features, where family and tenant farms and crofting are key parts of rural life. We want to see a tax system that supports and not hinders the orderly succession, planning and transfer of land to the next generation of custodians of the land.
Sue Webber.
Presiding Officer, I share the Minister's disappointment in what we've seen unfold, because Labour have betrayed Scottish farmers in their budget by introducing the family farm tax, and it's disappointing that so few members are in the chamber today. This is estimated to affect 70,000 family farms across the UK. Our food security will now be put at risk, and local people will be forced to pay higher prices in the supermarket as a result. Minister, will you support the Scottish Conservative campaign to reverse Labour's deeply harmful family farm tax?
Minister.
I have to say that there is very little with what Sue Webber is saying that I would disagree with. In fact, I will quote from NFUS. From a farming and crofting perspective, the inheritance tax and changes to agricultural property relief will be devastating to the vast majority of farms and crofts. This is something we will demand the UK Government to review and amend, as the pressure, both financially and mentally, this will put on family farming businesses will be immense. The sheer lack of understanding of how agriculture works throughout the UK has been highlighted by this Government, which has clearly gone back on its word. Changes to inheritance tax and agricultural property relief will affect the liquidity and succession of farms of above £1 million threshold set, hitting mainly family farms, regardless of the size or type. Decisions to reinvest in these farming businesses will be shelved, and the knock-on ramifications for the wider rural economy and business up and downstream will be significant. That's the NFU that are saying that. That's not a Scottish Government political statement. So what the Labour Party have done in Westminster has absolutely been catastrophic to the farming industry here in Scotland, and we would seriously urge the UK Government to rethink their position.
Supplementary, Elena Whittam.
I'm very thankful that this issue has actually been brought to the Chamber today. It's very important and it affects many of my constituents in Carrick, Cumnock and Doon Valley. As we have heard, the NFUS Scotland has said that this will be devastating to the vast majority of farms and crofts. What engagement has the Minister had with NFUS and the farming stakeholders in light of this very disappointing UK budget? And can you outline the support that is available to the sector in Scotland to ensure its viability for the years to come?
Always through the Chair, Minister.
Yeah, what I can say is, right at the very start of the new Labour government, myself and the Cabinet Secretary were actually very hopeful of a better line of engagement, a better dialogue and a much better relationship than, dare I say, our colleagues on the left here. And we discussed the importance of providing sufficient ring-fenced multi-annual funding to support agriculture, rural marine sectors across the UK, and to provide them with long-term clarity as soon as possible, noting that the UK Government would consider the funding settlement for future years at the next spending review. Well, all of that has now gone out the window. In terms of what the Scottish Government are doing, we're going to invest over £1 billion in 24-25 in the Rural Affairs and Land Reform and Islands budget. We have committed to support active farming and food production with direct payments to provide certainty to the industry, and we brought forward payment dates to pay farmers and crofters at the earliest possible opportunity to assist with cash flow. The UK Government Autumn Statement does not provide the uplift in agricultural funding that stakeholders have called for, or to reverse the real terms cuts of recent years, nor does it provide the required multi-year certainty that we lost when we exited the EU. The imposed settlement compounds the issues created by the former UK Government, and there really needs to be some serious conversations had going forward.
Supplementary, Tim Eagle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Well, we've got one Labour at the back shaking their head, one at the front looking at his phone, because this is pretty shameful spin coming out from Labour today about the inheritance tax, which is destroying family farms. Minister, engagement is the key. Presiding Officer, engagement is a really key...
Please.
You can shout all you like, but you know it's spin and I know it's spin. Engagement really is a key. The industry is hurting. I am pleased with what the Minister's been saying today, but will the Minister do all he can to engage with the industry, because they need it now more than ever?
Minister.
I cannot disagree with the sentiment of Tim Eagle. We are actively engaging. As soon as we got the budget, we started to engage with industry. We will continue to engage with industry because we need to get this sorted in order to assure the viability of family farming in Scotland.
And supplementary, Ariane Burgess.
While the Scottish Greens support using inheritance tax measures as a means of redistribution, the lack of information about the impact of the UK budget changes is making small farmers in the Highlands and Islands region nervous, and concerns have been raised that this could inadvertently lead to small farms ending up in the hands of big agribusiness. Can the Minister say what steps the Scottish Government will take to provide more information to the sector and ensure the changes don't have a negative impact on Scotland's land reform journey?
Minister.
All I can say to Ariane Burgess is the same answers that I've given to our colleagues on the left-hand side of the chamber, I should say, make that point, that we will continue to do all that we can to make sure that we have a successful, viable family farming sector in Scotland.
Question number three, not lodged. Question number four, Sandish Gohani.
To ask the Scottish Government by what date it expects all farmers to receive payment through the basic payment scheme.
Minister.
The payment strategy published on the 9th of February 2024 sets out our regulatory targets. For basic payment scheme, this is 95.24 of the BPS value by June 2025, which is on course due to be met. As in any year, there can be a number of complex cases which require further investigation to determine eligibility, and we will work with customers to pay the remaining claims at the earliest opportunity.
Sandish Gohani.
Thank you. Minister, whilst early payments are always welcome, I understand that only some smaller farms have received their single farm payment to date. On the 4th of September, the Cabinet Secretary stated Rural Payments and Inspections Division staff will continue to work through remaining payments as soon as possible over the coming weeks. That was 8 weeks ago. Following what for many has been a difficult harvest, it is now imperative that all farmers get this vital funding. Can the Minister give clarity to the industry by confirming when they will receive the rest, and will he guarantee this?
Minister.
If Sandish Gahane has specific cases that he wishes to raise with me, then by all means please bring it to our attention. There has been some delays, but we are still online, well online, to cover the vast majority of payments well within the timeline that we have. But as I say, if there are specific issues that he wants to bring to my attention, I'm more than happy to look at it.
Question number 8, Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And before I ask my question, I'd like to remind the Chamber of my register of interest in that I am part of a small family farm in Murrayshire, and as such I'm entitled to grants for the farming enterprise. To ask the Scottish Government what percentage of payments under the Rural Payment Scheme have been made by farmers by the 15th of October.
I think I made two farmers. Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And this actually will go some way to giving further clarity to Sandish Gahane as well. As at the 15th of October 2024, 76% of the overall value of the basic payment scheme had been paid out, with 83% of the total number of eligible businesses having received payment.
Edward Mountain.
I thank the Minister for that answer. I'm slightly concerned that the disastrous and expensive computer system installed to distribute the basic farm payment scheme has caused the delays that have been. Can the Minister please confirm if this is the case, and if not, were any delays caused by software issues?
Minister.
We are delivering in line with our payments. I fully understand the premise of Edward Mountain's question, given some of the issues that we had historically. But there was a planned pause in the payment run processing from the 12th of September to the 2nd of October in 2024. That was to allow the Scottish Government to incorporate wide upgrades to the Oracle Cloud to happen. The basic payment scheme and greening advance payment runs started again from the 2nd of October, and all claims progressed to ready for payment during the pause were processed by the 15th of October. Normal payment run is processing, and cadence resumed from this point onwards.
Supplementary, Colin Beattie.
It is vital that we press ahead with work to ensure that we are giving farmers and crofters the support they need. Can the Minister say any more about the total funding that has been provided to support farmers through the basic payment scheme this year?
Minister.
I think it's fair to say the Scottish Government absolutely recognises the importance of this support to farmers and crofters. And as at the 4th of November 2024, over £367 million worth of payments had been processed. As I said, that means 87% of the overall value of the basic payment scheme has been paid out, with 92% of the total number of eligible businesses receiving a payment.
And supplementary, Douglas Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I wrote to the Cabinet Secretary last month on behalf of a Moray farmer who normally gets his basic payment in September and has still not received it. Would it be possible to get a response from the Cabinet Secretary? But on the point we've heard about IT, this farmer has also been told by the department in Inverness that the software upgrade is going to delay future payments. And he describes it as a pretty stupid time to do an upgrade, and it must be a pretty slow one at that. Does the Minister agree?
Minister.
As I've just said in my previous answer, the payment system is back on track. The upgrade was happened across the entire Scottish Government. It wasn't just to do with the payment system for rural payments. But we are back on track. We will be well in time before the deadline of June 2025, and I hope that gives farmers confidence that the payments are coming.
Question number 5 has been withdrawn. Question number 6 was not lodged. I call question number 7, Bob Dorris.
To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Rural Affairs Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding the potential implications for its policies on land reform and land use of a carbon emissions land tax.
Cabinet Secretary.
Ministers meet regularly to ensure that work that is underway across government takes into consideration the potential cross-portfolio implications.
Bob Dorris.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. As a member of the Net Zero Committee, I am currently scrutinising land reform legislation. Under initial Scottish Government plans, large landowners will be required to consult
produce and comply with land management plans, and would also have constraints such as lotting placed on the sale of land. Given there may soon also be a requirement for large landowners to also pay a carbon emissions land tax, would the Scottish Government give consideration, with some potential exemptions and caveats, of aligning the qualifying threshold for all three to land ownership above 1,000 hectares? Such an approach may benefit communities, nature restoration and net zero.
Cabinet Secretary.
Say from the outset that, of course, I'm grateful for the committee's scrutiny of the Land Reform Bill. And the reason that we had set out the different thresholds was so that, I mean, that ultimately that was intended to ensure that the measures are justified in relation to the policy aims and don't then have a disproportionate impact on smaller land holdings. But, of course, I welcome the committee's consideration of these issues. The Scottish Government is committed to exploring options for a carbon land tax to support emissions reductions. But, of course, any potential new measures in relation to that would have to be rigorously assessed and based on strong evidence to ensure that they are meeting the objectives of what introducing a policy like that would be. And of course, in the development of that work, we'd be working with stakeholders, including landowners, to consider all available options, and that would include considering any relevant thresholds and what that might look like.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions on rural affairs. Could I maybe just finish the short statement? It concludes portfolio questions on rural affairs, land reform and islands. Point of order, Mr Eagle.
Sorry, in my frustration over the Labour's family farm tax, I forgot to declare my interest as a farmer and in receipt of basic payment scheme.
Thank you, Mr Eagle. That is now on the record. There will be a very short pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow front bench teams to change positions should they so wish. Thank you. Thank you. We will now move on to the next item of business, which is portfolio questions on health and social care. And at question number one, I call Graeme Simpson.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what recent discussions it has had with NHS Lanarkshire about the replacement Monklands Hospital.
Minister Marie Todd.
NHS Lanarkshire have provided an update to the NHS Capital Investment Group on 25th September on the progress they are making with the development of the full business case. The session confirmed that good progress is being made and that the Board remain on course to submit the full business case in late 25 or early 26.
Graeme Simpson.
Well, can I thank the Minister for that answer, but good progress doesn't mean money on the table, and that's what's required. Recent NHS Lanarkshire report dubbed Monklands Hospital a risk to life. It highlighted floods, bacterial outbreaks, major heating failures. Colin Lauder, the director of planning there, has said that Monklands is not suitable for 21st century medical practice, and there was a recent briefing for elected members in which we were told that not replacing Monklands is simply unthinkable. So, will the Minister commit to funding Monklands? And in a spirit of collaboration, will she agree to host a meeting of interested MSPs from the area to discuss this?
Minister.
Thank you. I thank the member for that question. First of all, I mean, I'll take the several points he raises. First of all, it really isn't the case that NHS Lanarkshire have not adequately made the case for replacement. It is absolutely the situation that we are still in the process of finding the money. Meantime, we expect all health boards to undertake appropriate maintenance work in their healthcare facilities in order to manage and to mitigate any risks. And we are continuing to work with health boards to manage estate-related costs. I absolutely recognise the importance of NHS infrastructure in supporting services, and to that end we are working with all of our health boards to develop a whole system infrastructure plan. And that's in the context of a very challenging financial position. This is a positive and a practical approach which reflects on the needs for the whole of Scotland and will support continued safe operation of our NHS existing facilities, as well as determination of longer term long-term investment priorities. On the question of meeting with members, I am very happy to meet with members any time to discuss the issues that interest them.
Thank you, Minister. And a supplementary, Richard Leonard.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. A report leaked just last month reveals that the existing Monklands Hospital is beyond its serviceable life. The replacement hospital has been delayed by 3 years already. A week ago, the Scottish Government learned it will have significant additional resources for the NHS from the new Labour Government. Will it use those additional resources to get this new hospital built as a matter of urgent priority?
Minister.
So, I think the consequentials from the budget last week turn out to be £89 million of capital, which, as we all know, does not build a modern hospital. We do welcome the clarity from the UK Government around our 25-26 capital funding envelope. We'll target that funding to deliver on the priorities of the Government. However, we do need longer-term assurance on, you know, sort of multi-year capital investment in order to commit to some of these enormous capital costs that are building within our NHS in Scotland.
Question number two, Emma Roddick.
Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what it is doing to establish a care pathway for people living with hypermobile Ehlers-Danlos syndrome and hypermobility spectrum disorders.
Minister Jenny Minto.
I can assure members that the Scottish Government, through the Rare Disease Implementation Board and wider engagement, remains committed to exploring how care for rare conditions can be improved through the use of pathways and resources that support healthcare professionals. Given how important it is that people with a rare or long-term condition receive effective care, and with predicted increases in the number of people with such conditions in Scotland, we believe it is time to revisit our approach to long-term conditions. We are exploring how to better support people with long-term conditions, as many of the outcomes we seek for patients are similar across different conditions.
Emma Roddick.
I thank the Minister for that answer, and I'm grateful to her for meeting with me last week to discuss this further. Research published by the University of Edinburgh earlier this year found that people with EDS and HSD in Scotland endure an average wait of 20 years for a diagnosis, and a significant number resort to private healthcare or travelling abroad as a result. I know well the knock-on impact that such a lack of support can have, as well as the frustration that comes from a lack of public awareness. Can the Minister outline what steps the Government is taking to ensure that the provision of training and education around EDS is enhanced?
Minister.
Thank you. I would like to thank and acknowledge the work that Emma Roddick is carrying out to raise awareness of EDS. As noted in August Progress Report on Scotland's Action Plan for Rare Diseases, our Rare Disease Implementation Board, in conjunction with NHS Education for Scotland, is developing awareness-raising video resources to support healthcare professionals in thinking rare. We will also be encouraging the use of digital tools like the Right Decision Service, hosted by Healthcare Improvement Scotland. This provides tools to build guidance, pathways and other decision support resources. Guidance for hypermobile Ehlers-Danlos syndrome has already been developed by NHS Dumfries and Galloway and is available on the Right Decision Service website to support healthcare staff across Scotland.
Question number three was not launched. Question number four, Lorna Slater.
To ask the Scottish Government, in light of recent reports that the Chalmers Gender Identity Clinic has paused gender-affirming surgery referrals for people under 25, what work is it doing to ensure that such referrals for 18 to 24-year-olds can be reinstated as soon as possible?
Minister Jenny Minto.
Before I answer Lorna Slater's question regarding NHS Lothian, I want to reassure the member and anyone listening to this session that there has been no change in national policy in relation to the provision of gender identity healthcare or related surgical referrals for 18 to 24-year-olds. NHS boards are responsible for the care of patients, and I understand that NHS Lothian are currently reviewing their internal clinical governance procedures to ensure their assessment and referral processes are meeting patients' needs in a holistic way. This work by NHS Lothian is ongoing, and I have asked that it is done at a pace to reduce anxiety for patients involved and ensure that referrals resume as soon as possible.
Lorna Slater.
I'll thank the Minister very much for that. In the wake of the Gender Identity Healthcare Protocol for Scotland being published by the Scottish Government in September, a number of constituents have written to me with the specific concern that Chalmers Gender Identity Clinic is waiting for the national work on gender identity healthcare provision for young people mentioned in point 8 of that protocol to be completed before they reinstate referrals. Knowing that timeliness of care is vital, that gender-affirming care saves lives, and that lives are potentially at risk while this is unavailable, can I ask the Minister how long this national work will take? And did the Minister anticipate clinics pausing support for patients while this work was undertaken? I note that NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde have not paused referrals.
Minister.
I thank Lorna Slater for her question. I understand that a short life working group established by NHS Lothian is progressing work at pace to consider pathways for 18 to 24-year-olds. I understand that this group is expected to report early in the new year. I also understand that as part of this process, if there are any interim steps, they can progress before the report concludes. These will be put into place as soon as possible by the board.
And supplementary, Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The overriding premise of healthcare professionals is to do no harm. So can the Minister confirm that the pause to gender-affirming surgery is at least in part to concern around the health outcomes from these treatments and can only be reinstated when a full investigation into harms or otherwise are recognised?
Minister.
I thank Brian Whittle for the question. As I understand, it was to do with the processes of referrals and such like, and that is what the short-term, short-life working group is looking on. And as I said in my response to Ms Slater, we expect the report to be concluded in early in the next year.
Question number 5, Colin Smith. Point of order, Martin Whitfield.
Apologies to you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The member is not in the chamber.
Yes, I thank Mr Whitfield for that helpful clarification, which I think we've all noted. I think he was in the chamber not quite so long ago. So apologies to those who were seeking supplementaries. Obviously, that's not going to be possible. Question number 6, Annie Wells.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it plans to improve life expectancy and tackle any health inequalities affecting the most disadvantaged communities.
Minister Jenny Minto.
Thank you. This government has an unwavering commitment to increase life expectancy and reduce health inequalities across our communities by undertaking a range of actions to address the underlying causes. These include allocating around £3 billion a year since 2022-23 to tackle poverty, initiatives to promote healthy lifestyles through tobacco control, preventing alcohol-related harm, promoting healthy eating and being physically active. We are working with our partners to develop a collective preventative approach to tackle health inequalities through the creation of a population health framework. The most recent life expectancy figures published last month by the National Records of Scotland indicate a moderate increase for both men and women compared with previous estimates.
Annie Wells.
I thank the Minister for that answer. The leading causes of avoidable deaths include alcohol and drug-related conditions. People living in the most deprived fifth of areas are 2 to 3 times likely as those then living in the least deprived areas to die from such causes, which are categorised as being potentially preventable through treatment. And what is the Scottish Government's response to calls from the RCGP Scotland to increase the investment in general practice alongside the review of all funding streams to channel more spending to the most deprived areas?
Minister.
I thank Annie Wells for her question and also welcome her to her new portfolio and look forward to meeting her with regards to women's health. Annie Wells raises some really important points around dependency on alcohol and drugs in our deprived areas and her suggestion with regard to discussions with GPs and that funding, we are very receptive to.
Supplementary, Claire Hawkey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I refer members to my register of interest? I'm employed as a bank nurse by Greater Glasgow and Clyde NHS. Can the Minister advise of how successful the Inclusion Health and General Practice Programme has been in tackling health inequalities across disadvantaged areas of Greater Glasgow and Clyde, and how this work will be supported over the next year?
Minister.
Thank you. Since March 2023, we have invested £2.3 million in the Inclusion Health Action and General Practice project in Greater Glasgow and Clyde. More than 60 GP practices in highly disadvantaged communities have used the funding for practical actions to tackle health inequalities. An early evaluation published in July clearly shows that the funding is driving improvements in those practices. This includes enhanced care through over 7,000 extended or outreach consultations with patients who have complex health needs, yet are often excluded from health care. Over 200 staff have also undertaken training related to health inequalities. £1 million was paid to practices this financial year to continue their work to address health inequalities.
And supplementary, Paul Sweeney, who's joining us online. Mr Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The reality of health inequalities in Scotland are persistently laid bare in the National Dental Inspection Programme data. For example, last week's figures showed that just 60% of children in the most deprived areas showed no obvious decay experience, compared to 84% in the least deprived areas. Has the government accepted this level of inequality in dental health as standard in Scotland?
Minister.
Thank Paul Sweeney for his question, and no, the Scottish Government has not accepted these levels in dentistry as standard, as we continue to invest in Child Smile to ensure that our children get the best support they can when learning to brush and keep their teeth clean, because I think we all recognise that the mouth is one of the key areas to which shows your general health, and it's important to have your teeth health as high as possible.
Question number 7, Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it is improving outcomes for people affected by breast cancer.
Cabinet Secretary Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We're implementing the Cancer Strategy and Cancer Action Plan for Scotland that take a comprehensive approach to improving patient pathways in cancer, from prevention and diagnosis through to treatment and post-treatment care. We continue to invest in our Detect Cancer Earlier programme. We have invested £11.3 million of cancer waiting times funding in 24-25 directed towards our most challenged tumour types, including breast cancer. And we commissioned the Scottish Cancer Network to publish the first national clinical management pathway for breast cancer in 2023, bringing consistency to the patient journey from diagnosis onwards to improve outcomes.
Claire Adamson.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer, and would urge any women in screening programmes to take up those opportunities. In light of the National Cancer Medicines Advisory Group, the Council issuing advice supporting the use of anastrozole, raloxifene and tamoxifen for the primary prevention of breast cancer, what steps have been taken to establish the necessary NHS pathways to ensure these medicines are readily available for women who choose these risk-reducing treatment options?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank Claire Adamson for her question. Recognise her interest in this area that is long-standing, and reiterate her call for women and all others to take up cancer screening opportunities when they present themselves. I welcome the National Cancer Medicines Advisory Group's decision to support the use of anastrozole and tamoxifen and raloxifene treatment to reduce the risk of breast cancer. The Scottish Government is currently working with National Genetic and clinical colleagues to consider the implications of undertaking a nationally agreed pathway for chemo prevention of breast cancer. And in the meantime, the Scottish Government expects health boards to explore the safe, effective and equitable introduction of these medicines.
Supplementary, Colin Beattie.
I understand there has been a recent confirmation of significant shortages of radioisotopes across the world, those of which are mainly used for diagnosing cancers including prostate and breast cancer. Can the Cabinet Secretary please outline the Scottish Government's latest position following this announcement and advise how it will support affected parents and their loved ones?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. I thank Colin Beattie for raising an important issue that has been of concern to me over recent weeks. Work is ongoing with suppliers, and the UK Government has a responsibility in terms of medicine supply to resolve the shortages of generators used in the preparation of radioisotopes in nuclear medicine for both diagnosis and treatment, particularly for cancer. There have been positive developments with the affected reactors in Poland and the Netherlands having come back online sooner than expected, and consequently we should shortly be able to confirm that all radio pharmacies in Scotland will receive their normal generator capacity. I would like to take the opportunity to thank the radio pharmacy and associated clinical teams in Scotland for working collaboratively to minimise the impact of this shortage on patient care, and the work that's been done across the UK to coordinate this, and I intend to keep colleagues both across the Chamber and particularly the committee updated as matters progress.
And supplementary, Sandish Gohani.
The Declaration of Interest as a practising NHS GP. My constituent, Shireen Ogbarrally, was diagnosed with breast cancer and underwent a mastectomy. As you can imagine, this was devastating for her. She requires breast reconstructive surgery at the Glasgow Royal Infirmary, but on asking when she might receive it, was simply told years. Pam Gosnell raised this issue at FMQs last November and was told by the First Minister that the Scottish Government were working hard to reduce waiting times. But an FOI shows Glasgow's average wait has increased, maximum wait has increased, number of patients waiting has increased. This is unacceptable. When will the Cabinet Secretary take steps to improve the situation, and will he apologise to Shireen?
Cabinet Secretary.
I very much recognise the trauma that Shireen, Dr. Gohani's constituent will be feeling at this time. I'm sorry for the delay that she will have in that important reconstructive surgery. We are investing in providing support to boards to provide capacity for this work. And Dr. Gohani, in his question and his narration, referenced the fact that there is an increased demand upon these services. Indeed, both the 62-day and the 31-day cancer pathway for breast cancer, we are seeing an increased demand, and we're treating more people within those pathways than compared to pre-pandemic. That is cold comfort to Shireen. I recognise that, and if there is anything more that can be done to help in that circumstance, I'd be more than happy to hear more from Dr. Gohani in writing as the individual circumstances.
And supplementary, Karen Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary will know from public health figures that the gap between our most and least deprived communities remain stubbornly high. Women between the age of 50 and 70 from our most deprived communities are less likely to attend their routine breast screening appointments, with a 64.2% screening rate compared to 82.8% in the most affluent. Given I have raised screening inequalities in the Chamber on a number of occasions, and given the Government's commitment to reducing inequalities in cancer screening, will the Cabinet Secretary agree to bring a debate to the Chamber to give us an update on the status of the equity and screening strategy and allow scrutiny of the Government's commitment to targeted work in this area?
Cabinet Secretary.
The scheduling of parliamentary business is a consideration for all of us to think about, but I recognise Carol Mochan's request there, and also the figures that she narrates, which I have seen, and I am just as concerned as she is around the current inequity that there is between the most and the least deprived areas and the uptake for screening opportunities. It serves to illustrate, as I did in response to Claire Adamson, the need for us to reiterate the importance of people taking up the screening opportunities that are there, and if there are structural barriers to those in the most deprived communities being able to get access to them, we need to tackle those, and I'd be very interested in working with local boards and health and social care partnerships around how that could be brought about. So we'll give due consideration to a request for chamber time, but in the meantime I'd be more than happy to discuss those areas with her in a further meeting.
Question number 8, Sharon Dowie.
Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what steps it is taking to eliminate long waits in A&E departments across Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm committed to addressing long waits within our emergency departments, which is why we're supporting health boards through our Urgent and Unscheduled Care Collaborative Improvement Programme to improve patient flow through our acute sites. The key issue impacting performance is inpatient capacity and the block this causes for people who need admitted to the hospital. We're working with the Centre for Sustainable Delivery and local systems through our improvement approach to implement actions that will release inpatient capacity, such as strengthening same-day emergency care services, optimising flow navigation centres and enhancing the discharge process to ensure people are discharged as soon as they are medically fit.
Sharon Dowie.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. A&E waiting times have risen and remain critically high across Scotland. More than 9,000 patients were not seen within the SNP's four-hour target in the week ending 27th of October. In Ayrshire and Arran, only 63.9% of patients were seen within 4 hours at emergency departments. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what immediate actions he will take to protect staff from burnout and improve the patient experience as we prepare for increased winter pressures?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, President Officer. I thank Sharon Dowie for bringing this really important issue to the Chamber. We have too many people waiting too long in our acts and emergencies, particularly to get admitted. I was able to see that for myself, not just on Monday when I was at University Hospital Ayr, but when I was at University Hospital Ayr earlier in the summer, visiting the acts and emergency. I think they have brought in good innovations, including the frailty assessment unit that they have brought in there, but there is a clear variation in performance from our health and social care partnerships in the performance around delayed discharge. And we can see that within Ayrshire and Arran, where South Ayrshire delays are sitting at 91 in September, in East Ayrshire that was 25, and North Ayrshire that's 74. So we need to understand what can be done to make sure that we are bringing up that performance of all of those local areas so that we can see that better flow through the system. And that is a commitment that I have just made to all health and social care partner chairs and vice chairs in a meeting before this session, as I do on a weekly basis with the CRAG on what is needed in local areas to see a response, to see these numbers coming down so that we can see a better flow in our acts and emergency settings.
Supplementary, Joe Fitzpatrick.
Thank you. Presiding Officer, we know that a key way to reduce the pressure on A&E is ensuring that people know where to go to access the healthcare that they need. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide an update on the work to alleviate pressures on emergency departments and what can be learned from exemplar A&E departments like those in NHS Tayside? And can he comment on how A&E wait time figures in Scotland compare to those across the rest of the UK?
Briefly, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Right Care, Right Place campaign launched last week. It promoted awareness around the appropriate use of the urgent care services to help reduce pressures on the system during winter. Alongside this, record number of NHS 24 call handlers are available to direct people to the most appropriate care, helping to reduce unnecessary accident emergency attendances. To directly answer Joe Fitzpatrick's question, Scotland's core accident emergencies have been the best performing in the UK for 9 years. Monthly statistics for September show that Scotland's performance for core A&Es was 6.1 percentage points higher than England, 8.7% points higher than Wales. I do not rest on that, Presiding Officer. It is not good enough for us just to be the best in the UK. We must do better for the people of Scotland. That's what I'm committed to doing.
Supplementary, Jackie Bailey.
Yesterday's Public Health Scotland statistics revealed that A&E departments are continuing to struggle, with the latest monthly figures showing 13,000 people waiting over 8 hours to be seen, 5,000 of them over 12 hours. We see ambulances backed up at the hospital front door, causing huge pressure on the system and delays to them getting to further emergency calls. So will the Cabinet Secretary commit to using some of the new funding from the UK Labour budget to tackle the winter pressures on our NHS and social care?
Cabinet Secretary.
Very much agree with the first point that Jackie Bailey provides the assessment through Public Health Scotland figures as to the challenges that there are across the system. I would say that it's not the performance of accident emergency departments. I think that they are doing very well. It is the performance of the entire system that we need to look at, including social care, as I was narrating to Sharon Dowie. But I take the point that she makes. In terms of the impact that the UK budget has made, I think that it's a mixed bag. There is undoubtedly progress that is being made. But for this year, the consequentials were, as had been anticipated, both telegraphed from previous UK government as well as this one. And we will use all possible resources to improve the situation for our health services, and we'll take forward the progress in that front as we develop the budget process coming forward on the 4th of December.
And supplementary, Willie Rennie.
It is bewildering that the Cabinet Secretary tells us it's about flow through the hospital, including social care. But in Fife, we've got £13 million worth of social care cuts agreed to by NHS Fife, and that's having a direct impact on social care packages and respite. That has a direct impact on discharge from the hospital. So why on earth is he telling us that it's about the flow through the hospital when he's imposing these kind of cuts?
Cabinet Secretary.
Partly because, as Mr Rennie knows, it's not me that's imposing these cuts, that these are local decisions that are being taken. But I want to work with local systems because I recognise that there is a pressure across the public sector after a decade and a half of austerity. And I recognise the challenges that are being faced in local areas, including within Fife. And that's why I'm meeting on a weekly basis with the whole system through the Collaborative Response and Assurance Group that is including COSLA, it includes Health and Social Care Partnerships, and concerns around funding are able to be voiced in that forum, and we would take those points seriously in order to address the situation that are being faced by too many partnerships and too many individuals, because at the end of the day these are people that are experiencing delays to being discharged to their home or indeed not being able to get into the hospital or into the accident emergency department, and that is what I'm focused on, seeing a better situation for those people that are using our health and social care services.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions on health and social care. I actually had first on my screen a point of order from Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I apologise for getting my timings wrong for health questions? And I'll write to the Presiding Officer to apologise for missing my question.
Thank you, Mr Smith. Point of order, Finlay Carson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In light of the response we've just heard, can the Presiding Officer offer any advice to those members who were preparing to ask a supplementary on an urgent matters such as maternity services in Dumfries and Galloway, given the outrageous decision by the IGB to ignore views of pregnant women and independent maternity professionals to withdraw midwife-led services?
Mr Carson, that is not a point of order. There will be many opportunities for a member to raise issues, as he well knows, but I see also that the Cabinet Secretary wishes to make a point of order. Cabinet Secretary.
As ever, if any questions are not taken, thank you, Presiding Officer, if any questions are not taken in the Chamber, I'd be more than sympathetic to writing in a timorous fashion back to members whose questions were not able to be taken.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And there'll be a short pause before we move on to the next item of business. Thank you.